depression and emotional reaction is very common after stroke. Some of the changes in mood might be caused by the stroke and the effect on the brain, and so perhaps some of the depressed mood or the decreased in motivation, which is common in depression, is a direct effect of the stroke. And some people get a fluctuating mood, which may be a direct effect of the stroke. The very common emotional reactions, of course, are to do with the adjustment of this huge event that's happened. It's important not to to make judgments too early on about how things are going to be. But as time goes on, it can become apparent to people that, yes, they will have significant losses. Things that they were able to do, they're no longer able to do. So for some people, this will be a very physical thing. They're no longer able to walk as briskly or walk well or even walk. Certainly not able to work. Distinguishing whether a person is depressed in stroke can be a bit difficult, because the common ways that depression is expressed is through emotional, that is sadness and being depressed. People with stroke have physical effects in their body, so they move slowly and could look depressed. People who get depressed lose motivation for things, so their drive is diminished. And of course, there are physical effects of reduced appetite and sleep disturbance, which are common in depression as well. Those things can be evident in stroke. Sometimes we think, is that just the stroke? But that should not be assumed. An important part of adjusting to a life event like a stroke is to adjust to the giving up of what perhaps you were previously doing or previously hoping for. Readjusting in the sense of discovering a new life, you know, discovering what my abilities are and what I am able to do. And life goes on, it's just different. Productive work, which is very important for all of us in our sense of self-esteem, can change, but finding something that is useful and meaningful to do is very important. We know that if a person is depressed, their outcome, their recovery, their level of functioning is severely impaired. And so depression impacts on motivation for rehabilitation, motivation for getting up in the morning, motivation for engaging with life, and treating depression is very important in stroke.
Oh, hi Max, it's Tracy. How are you going?
In the first instance, it's important to acknowledge it and to talk to people. Just being able to express to another person the difficulties you're having, the frustrations you're having, is important. I think there are a number of reasons why when we're in these sort of circumstances, don't talk to others, talk to family or talk to doctors. One is that we might feel we're burdening other people. We can feel ashamed that, you know, we should be coping with this. Sometimes we think that the other person, say the GP, has not got time to hear this, or that's not his or her job, that they're just involved in my physical care, and that's important not to think that. Care of the whole person is very important. Some people are unable to communicate clearly, and that could be they have something they want to say but can't put it into words, or sometimes they can't even form the words in their mind, and that's very frustrating, and if you can't communicate with people around you. The GP is a person who a patient or their carer can very reasonably expect support and help from and should talk to. There are support groups, that is, groups of people who've gone through similar experiences, and that can be very encouraging and supporting to see how other people have coped. Okay. Counselling can be very important, cognitive behavioural therapy, in some cases medication. Antidepressant medication is effective in treating depression in patients with stroke. It's important to think about the effects on the carer, that is the person who's closest to the person with a stroke, because the impact on them is enormous, and maybe we could say just as enormous as for the person with a stroke, because their life is really turned upside down.
Oh, Emma, does this go any higher?
And as well as the emotional coping, there is the daily grind of doing the things that need to be done, in this case, for care, additionally, for caring for the person who needs help. That is a major task for people going through these sort of crises, both to cope with the emotional side of things, but to cope with the practical day-to-day things. Clearly, the task of recovery is a shared task that is shared by the patient, their carer, and also the professionals. I think it's important to be realistic about that and to understand what the caring role is. And it can be very difficult if the patient, the person with the stroke, is struggling to get motivated. It's very hard for another person to be able to get them doing things. And that's why it's so important that the whole team, the health professionals and family are all involved.
Put your groceries up here.
Being a carer can be a real drain on the person, both physically and emotionally. It can lead to deprived sleep and a poor eating and, you know, in many ways, self-neglect. So carers, it's a difficult task, obviously, but carers do have to look after themselves, make time for themselves, get respite care if necessary to give themselves some time out. Carers can become depressed in real clinical ways that will impede their ability to do what they really want to do, which is care. And so they have to look after themselves and in some circumstances get help. And that help, as for anyone who's depressed, can be counselling and sometimes medication. After the acute crisis, life goes on, and it's important to think about engaging in life, and it helps recovery to start to think early about engaging in doing those things that bring pleasure. Some of the things that one did in the past may not be able to be done, but there are new things, and it's important to give oneself, both for the survivor and the carer, time doing pleasurable things, going out. It's important to realise that help is available, that depression can be treated and needs to be treated and should be treated. And there's a range of treatments of counselling, psychotherapy and medication that are readily accessible. Also, information and advice simply about depression and why people get depressed and what is depression can be very reassuring to people, and to understand that even though they are suffering, it's normal. And normal does not mean to be ignored, but it's a person is not going crazy simply because they feel stressed and depressed. Although we can seek professional help for counselling, we shouldn't split the care too much. Patients want to talk to their normal doctor who knows them well, understands their physical predicament and what's happening, about the emotional issues. And so doctors, physiotherapists, etc., should not be averse to just asking that question about how patients are going emotionally, and then directing them to care if that is required. It's important for health professionals to maintain hope. In these sort of situations, it's easy to be pessimistic, but both for the patient but also for the health professionals, and to give patients and their carers some vision for an optimistic life in the future.